this now is Guy Maker, Mark Powell. Welcome to the show, Mark. Firstly, tell us a bit about yourself.
Well, my dad revolutionised the comic business in 1976. There was a one-line kite before that, but in 1976, my dad's two-line version of the kite absolutely swept the world and won Toy of the Year.
Okay, your dad's Peter Powell. He's sitting there. We can see him over there. You've got dad to the show. Hi, Peter. How are you doing? And, yeah, so basically, the kites before your dad invented his famous kite, they were just one string, weren't they?
Just a ball and one-line kite. That was it.
So it was one of those things where you run down the beach,
right? You had to run with those kites,
I remember that as a kid, don't you? Just being really frustrated and run along with, like, something on the end of a string that didn't ever take off.
That's right.
Dad, show me how to do it. Yeah. Get your dad to run. Yeah.
There's not enough wind. If you're running with it, there's not enough wind.
Right.
You should just stand still with these kites now.
So how do you know when to write them out of wind, then?
Kites, you know, makers and kite flyers, they're normally always looking out the open the curtains. If you can see the trees moving gently, you know, if you go up to the top of the hill, or on a beach, it's perfect weather.
Where's the best place to fly a kite?
In parks, but the only problem with flying in a park is you've got buildings, you've got trees, so you get buffety wind.
Right.
Go up a hill, it's the best
up
place.
Up a hill. So the history of the kite, when was it invented and what for?
Well, you could go back 3,500 years. It goes back a long way. It could even go back before that, not too sure.
But what were they made of then?
The very, very first kites, I believe, were probably made out of plant, a leaf, and bits of bamboo. Very light.
But were they toys originally, or do they have?
Kids must have just used them as fun. But yeah. Then it got more practical. People started using them for different things.
Okay, tell us about your dad's story then. What happened then? It was a one string. What was his thought process then?
He was in a park in Shirlington. Where we brought up, called the Bell, and a friend of his, Trevor Kilby, was flying a one-line kite, a bit like one of these fighter kites. It was spinning around in one direction, and then my dad attached a line to the other side, pulled it gently, and it stabilised the kite. As he looked round, the kite did a spin. He thought, hey, what happened there? Look back again, now we can steer the kite.
Right.
But there were three lines on the kite. The beauty came is when he chopped the middle line away, then it was just the two lines.
And the brilliant thing is, Pete told us earlier, he dreamt it.
He dreamt getting
rid of the middle string.
And
I have one of these. My mum bought it for me for a birthday present once. And they are immense, aren't they? The power of them when you get them going.
Yeah.
Really, just...
And the fact that you're standing still. So you're not having to run along. So once it's up, you're properly going. Yeah, you feel like getting tugged away.
If you're running back with a kite, there's not enough wind.
Right.
Have a picnic, that's what I always say.
And then we saw world domination, the two-string kite. Yeah. It's just gone worldwide now.
It went massive. Yeah. Absolutely. My dad's product went worldwide overnight. He was producing 300 kites a week. Then he went to three factories. He had 25,000 kites a week. And then in his heyday was 75,000 a week, which he then outsold Lego and won the Toy of the Year that year.
And did he sell one to Muhammad Ali as well?
Muhammad Ali, Henry Fonda, James Stewart, all the rich and famous at that time.
Okay, that's good. What were they used for then? Are kites just generally used for entertainment purposes?
They are now, but if you go back like a couple of hundred years ago, they were used during the war and all sorts of things.
Yeah. Right. For what purpose in the war?
Aerial photography. Looking down over the battleground.
What was the forerunner of the drone?
We've got a drone now.
Yeah,
I suppose. Yeah, have the strings changed at all?
On our new model, they've changed slightly, but they're a much stronger line.
Because I invented something not so long ago when I was flying my kite, I forgot to tell anyone.
Mm-hmm.
But retractable strings, it does annoy you at the end of the day, winding all the strings. Why can't you just have it so you go zzz, zzz, zzz?
Takes all the fun out of it.
Really?
Dog walkers. Do you like getting in a tangle? We like getting in a tangle.
Tangle-free strings, like your headphone.
Oh, okay, that's good.
Yeah.
Have you melted it yet?
Don't tell anyone.
Most of these lines now, they're sort of coated in a wax.
Yeah.
So they don't tangle up.
We got some footage. Yeah, they don't tangle up, right.
Yeah.
We got some footage here of in Brazil where they actually do kite flying on top of rooftops. How does this work then? What do they do?
Well, basically, you've got the same kite.
They're fighting each other.
Basically, when the kite is pointing in the right direction you want it to go, you just give the line a stiff pull, then that kite will go in that direction. And the purpose is they got to cut each other's kites out of the sky. So, and the way they do that is the line that they fly on is dipped in glass powder. And then what they do is cross the lines, give it a good yank, and hopefully it cuts you a couple of
things. Brilliant.
That's
a thing.
Yeah. But there could be up to like 1 million people in like Afghanistan or Brazil at one time flying all these kites.
Wow.
So the last person, he's a local hero.
Okay. That's brilliant. Thank you very much. Right,
cheers. Thank you, Mark. Now, after the break, Catherine Parton joins us to make esteemed soul film.
See you soon.